Hungry? Order your favorite meals and drinks from hundreds of restaurants through the best app and have your food delivered to your doorstep. Download the app-free delivery app now.
Mark.
Yeah.
That food has come.
Oh my God. There's like, ish.
It's come through.
It has come through. I'm like just trying my hardest best to avoid the public seeing my pot belly. Oh man, eating too much.
And that's courtesy of Afri Delivery.
Yeah, Afri Delivery.
I'm gonna shout those guys out because yeah, really, man, being in a foreign country,
yeah,
not understanding the system, download it's, that app. They deliver the food right to your door.
Yeah, yeah.
Different selection today. What have we had? Indian.
Indian, amazing. Amazing food. I love Indian so much.
Yeah, thanks
for
putting us up.
Yeah. And of course, the Afri Delivery did come through. I love it. I mean, the timing was good and everything. That's perfect. Yeah.
Anyway, let's continue this conversation.
Sure.
So where we left it off, you had told me that the two singles that you had dropped of Pompey's before.
You're right.
Were
Giant Killer and No Rent.
Yeah. And No Rent, you rapped on it.
Yeah, No Rent, I rapped on it.
Let me ask you, from a production perspective.
Right.
How do you work?
So from a production,
like creating like something like Jet Killer was huge.
Yeah, I think for me, my formula is very simple. What I would say is I always take into consideration the people, and when I say the people, I take into consideration the artist. I take into consideration the listeners.
Mm.
Yeah. So I think a lot about target audience and things like that. I think a lot about what the artist, how the artist wants to feel when they sing the music, you know, because there are songs that, and obviously this comes from many lessons.
Yeah.
There are songs that I did, let's say with Tio, and you know, Tio was always like the person that, because he was the first artist I ever produced, like officially, and there was a lot of stuff I was learning on him, you know, experimenting with him, yeah. And what would happen is there would be songs that would feel comfortable for him, and there are songs that just because it's a good song, but it wasn't just a comfortable song to perform, to, you know what I mean? So What I've learned is that whatever I'm making, I need to make sure the artist is comfortable with it,
and the audience
is comfortable with it, and obviously coming up with a good middle ground for all of that.
Yeah, because sometimes an artist can be too creative, and that's so. Yeah, it's only them
who can feel it. Yes, exactly. So my job is to say, okay, this song, who are you singing it to? You know what I mean? And then you ask, will the people you're trying to sing to, will they get that song? Will they understand what you're talking about? Yeah, I mean, of course, there's people who do like high art, like very, you know, skillfully produced and played, and you know, like there's this complicated, like these jazz pieces that can be very sophisticated, or these scores. But you know, and they have their place, they have their market. But I guess it's again asking yourself, who are you singing to?
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so,
because you've worked with diverse people.
Right,
so
yeah.
So I just wanted to sort of get an understanding.
Yeah.
Okay, so you dropped this Pompey album.
Right.
Reception is crazy.
Reception is crazy, yeah. And everyone has heard. I actually think that him doing that Miju album made him a bigger artist than he ever was as a secular artist, which is crazy because, you know, normally, when a secular artist becomes a gospel artist, they dip. But Pompey became like much bigger. He was literally, even till now, you can put him on the top 10 of Zambian artists, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, and it all started from that Miju album. Everyone who was playing it at the time, and like I said, the game had changed. This was in 2012 going into 2013.
Okay, yeah.
People were now starting to, CDs were not really as big of a deal as they used to be.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, everything was streaming. It was all coming in, you know, like downloading music off the net and stuff like that. That's pretty much what was going on. And people were also, you know, wanted things quick. So no one was really interested in hearing a whole album. They would prefer just hearing a single. So, and then Pompey comes through with this album and everyone is listening to the entire album. It wasn't the entire album. So it's people knew and...
And you did the entire album?
I produced the entire album, yes, yes, yes.
Rats.
Lord of House.
Rats. Rats. They got to understand the anointing. Yeah. Everybody got a giant. Yeah. Most of them unseen. But we gonna bring them down. Cool, calm, collected. Standing in front of a charging army. Ooh. Yes, I reckon 007 got nothing on me. Full armor, not like Osama. Ushaka Zulu with his sangoma. With Christ alone, I always stand taller. Lelo Goliath, wala pona. Batizona, Suzi Gonda Iwe. Badi Konse Kosangande Onga Sanke Ine. I be like, oh, really? Can't even get near me. Semu Semu na Johnny Cena, you can't see me. Line quite cheesy, but the point still remains though. Nizaku Pasadindo, Sifutika Munga Pencil. Or Pencilo, however you pronounce it. Destiny really set, but me no need to announce it. Nuts. I am a giant killer. I am a giant killer. Small axe, I will chop you down in part the sea. When they try, they drown in. I am a giant killer. 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 Iwe man, osani basazina yakona kan.
Yeah, that's probably the biggest album I've ever produced to date, you know. So it was when I think about it, I think that was the first album. Oh snap! Yeah, I never thought about that. Was the first album I ever produced. Yeah, of course I produced
like to release.
To release, yeah. Yes, I produced songs in people's projects. But not like I never produced an entire album, first of all. And so that was the first time from track one to the end, each song produced by me, which was the very first time.
Man.
Yeah.
So that album has got packaging to Refuge,
mm-hmm.
Giant Killer.
Mulungu Samagona. Yes. That song. Beautiful song. Yes, yeah. And
so you, how would you work? You'd sit down with Pompey, he gives you a tune, and then now
yeah. So that's the thing. And like I said, for my process, I want the artist to, because the thing is,
Do you make beats? Like, are you the kind of guy who's like right now, say, give me a beat, and then you put a whole beat, then I write to that. Or do I come with an idea? Which one is better?
Okay, because you see, I can make, if you sing me a song, right? I can translate that song into any genre you want. I can make it rumba, I can make it R&B, I can make whatever you want.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah, because the thing is, all music follows the same principles. Beat count, tone, you know, they're just minor adjustments. Like maybe this could be a 3-4, this could be a 4-4.
Yeah.
But basically, all of them have a tempo.
Okay.
They have a key. They all have the same. They all follow the same principles, pretty much. You know, you have to be on a certain key and all that stuff. So, which is why it's important that the visionary, who is the artist, communicates their vision for the song. Yeah.
I love that.
So when they communicate their vision for the song, then now you know what you do, you know what not to make, and you now try and find that middle ground.
Okay.
So now what also happens is that I obviously I want a bit of my influence on that track, because otherwise they wouldn't have come to me.
Yep.
So it's now trying to say, how do we, it's like a marriage. how do you merge these two ideas and make something that is amazing? Yeah. So I before the session even starts, we are just talking. We spend at least 30 minutes talking about what we want, reference ideas, maybe play a few songs that they think sound familiar to what they want, and just build and just talk and build a relationship with the person, understand their personality, and then, you know, then it helps me now get into the production of it. Yeah.
Okay. So that same year you released the second album, Teal.
Right. Yes.
Or
yes.
Is Abel next?
So now from there, first after Pompey, next album we released was Abel's. Yeah. Then after Abel's, no. Actually, because all these albums came out in the 1 month, because we're working.
Without deadline.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Yes. So now, when Pompey released his album, then Tio released his album, who also had an amazing show at there's Lusaka Playhouse, which is like our only theater hall in Zambia. So it was very significant that he released his first album there. So Tio released it there, and then Abel released his album at Miracle Life.
Yeah.
Yeah. So. Now all these albums.
Did you do beginning to end all production?
All production, yes, on Tio. Yeah.
And Abel.
Same. End to end. Abel.
Sheesh.
Yeah. So I mean, of course, you know, in the end, like I said, it's a good team effort. I don't play all the instruments. Mm. So I don't play the guitars. Most of the guitars were played by a guy called Sam Chitundu. In fact, all the guitars were played by Sam Chitundu, who's actually Ian, who's my business partner. So he's Ian's young brother.
Oh,
so
nice.
Sam Chitundu, Ian Chitundu mixed all the songs. So it's still, so all the songs, so
family.
Yeah. So it is still a group effort. And like I said, the only reason why I'm able to change sounds, produce a worship song for Abel and produce like an almost dancehall song for Pompey, and produce an R&B song for Tio is because they are part of the production.
Yeah, I get it.
They are part of the production because they tell me what kind of bed they want their music, their vocal to lay on, you know. So yeah, so those three came out.
Now what does that do to you guys as a stable?
Yeah.
Doesn't that just drive crazy demand?
It was. I mean, from there on, like, I think that was amongst some of the most successful years for me, for any of the guys. Because now guys are getting booked to sing everywhere. It's not as easy to, I mean, I guess we became popular. We became popular,
you know,
yeah. Now the fame, and which is what I love, because now when I look at fame, right, I feel like what God taught me in that time when I was in the background producing is that it's not for me.
Yep.
You know what I mean? It's not to glorify myself. It's to glorify God, and then also, I need these people who are listening to this music. They are actually people. They are not just a number. So when you say you've got 50,000 followers, they are not just like, they are actual human beings.
Yep.
You see. So now you need to ask yourself, what are you? And the thing is, God loves each and every one of those 50,000. Like, He loves them the same way He loves you.
Yep.
So the same way you say, Lord, you fight for me, He's fighting for them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So now, what are you doing? What are you telling the people God loves? Are you misleading those people?
Yeah.
These are people that God loves.
Are you abusing the power you've been given?
Exactly. Are you abusing the power? And we will be held accountable for what we do what we are, how we lead God's people.
Mm.
You know, all of them, whether they are Christian or not, they are God's. Those are people that God loves, and we are responsible of. And that's what. And that's that was my big lesson during that time. And now I do it with an understanding of Magnus. You have a responsibility. If you are going to say, I'm going to be famous, you have a responsibility to these people. You are not just singing songs, get what you want and get out. I have high respect for pastors because they have to, you know, do this every Sunday and they have to be hands-on with the people. You know, at least for me, I can communicate on social media and what, but you know, pastors have to meet these people in person. And sometimes it's a lot. You know what I mean? It's a lot to be responsible over people.
Yep.
You know, and I think that's sort of been my understanding. And you know, of course, getting into so the music basically created this space where people know me.
Yeah.
And it was now. Of course, it was exciting. I mean, I'm not gonna say. I was just focusing on, I'm just here to serve you. No, you know, like, of course it was nice. You know, you go in the store, you want to buy groceries. People ask you for autographs, what. I mean, I won't say, you know, I'm Hollywood famous, but like with,
famous.
Yes. I'm, you know, like people, at least I know that there'll be an extra level of kindness because I'm Mag44. You know what I mean? Maybe the waiter will serve me a bit better. Because like, this is an artist, you know what I mean? So it's like, so like I totally enjoy the love. I totally enjoy the,
This time you haven't released your album. Let's just
Yes, here. I haven't released any album, yeah.
Yes.
So immediately after Pompey's album and drops, I drop, because now it's like, and I think that kind of put me under a lot of pressure.
Yeah.
Because it's like, okay, now what are you going to do?
Mm.
Pompey has dropped his album. Tio has dropped his album.
Let's Able. Say this. On each of these albums, you have collabos.
I have collabos,
so on
yes.
On Pompey's album, the collabo you have is?
No Rent. I'm on No Rent, yeah.
Only No Rent?
Only No Rent, yeah.
Okay. On Abel's
On album, Abel's, I am Chalo. On Chalo, yes.
Just
Chalo, yeah.
And then on
Tio's, I'm on Chikondi and another song called... Superhuman.
Yeah.
Yes, I'm on a song called Superhuman. Yeah.
Forgot, but
yes. Okay, I'm surprised you even know it. Okay, awesome. Cool.
So those are the ones that now you
yes.
Collab with. This thing has died.